speak about industrial hazards mitigation by water curtain, which is a topic that we have studied extensively in the von Karman. Speak about industrial hazards mitigation by water curtain, the major part being under the supervision of Jean-Marie Buclin, which is a professor also at the von Karman Institute, which I gladly thank to have landed me a lot of material to prepare this seminar. So water curtain, what for? They can be used for mitigating two main scenarios. The first one is a toxic gas release. The water curtain will act as diluting the gas, heating up in the case where it would hold like LNG or methane, but also absorb the gas in case it's soluble in water. But water curtain can also be used as a thermal shielding, so that would protect reservoir or other equipment, even personnel, from a fire by radiative attenuation. So during this seminar, I hope that by the end, you will know a bit more about what is a water curtain, how it can be used to mitigate gas dispersion, how it can be used for thermal shielding, and to make this a bit more applied, I will also provide some examples of scenarios and some design recommendations. So let's start by the beginning. Water curtain is based on sprays, and a spray is based on a phenomenon of atomization, which transform a bulk fluid, which it's considered as the continuous liquid phase, into a spray system, which would then be dispersed phase. The atomization process has two main, can be divided in two categories. The first one is the atomization is only used with the liquids, so the liquid will be atomized just because the potential energy will be transferred to the kinetic energy. But you can also atomize a liquid using the help of a pressurized gas that will interact with the liquid surface. In the case of water curtain, the sprays will be only with the liquid part to atomize. I think I will use the light bulb for it. That's better. You can have, depending on the geometry of the nozzle, you can create different spray patterns. One of the mostly applied for water curtain is the full cone. So from the side view, you see that it looks like a cone. And if you look from the bottom, the print of the water fills the whole cone. You can also have hollow cone, which is also a cone from the side view. But if you look from the bottom, the water only fills the envelope of the sprays. You could also have a flat pattern, so which is also a cone from the side view, but from the bottom it's only a linear impact. If you use air atomizing, which I already mentioned that it's not really the application here, but for general culture, let's say, when using air, you can have more complex shapes for the spray pattern, as you can see in this room. For a spray characteristics, how can you define a spray? So the first quantity of interest is the orifice diameter. So that's where the water will pass. Then you have the spray angle. So the spray, when it will be generated, the water will be atomized, it will create an angle. So you see that, and this angle will has a first initial angle close to the nozzle, and then due to the entrainment of air, will decrease close to the wall. And you see that the theoretical spray is different from the actual width. And a very important number to characterize a spray that we will use a lot in this seminar is the flow number, which is the ratio between the liquid mass flow rate and the square root of the operating pressure. that you apply into the nozzle to atomize. And if you go to extensive dimensional analysis, you can see that this is kind of proportional to the orifice diameter to the square. Another important characteristic of a spray that will be useful in the models for the mitigation is the droplet size, because of the spray will not generate one single size of droplet. You can, but most of the time it's not the case. And it's important to know the distribution of this droplet size. So either the data sheet will provide this when you buy the spray, but it's not always there. So one possibility to have more information about this is to use a PDI instrument, which is a phase Doppler anemometer. And it consists of two laser beams that cross, and the cross of these two laser beams create a probe volume. And in that probe volume, you can measure both the velocity and the diameter of all the droplets that will pass through this probe volume, which means that you can have very good statistics. So one example of measurement here, you see that it's the distribution of the droplet size at one place in the spray, and one location, so which means also that you can look how the distribution evolves in the spray. And you see that you can model distribution by a log normal law. You can also use a Rosling-Armler law, but log normal usually works. And you see the description here, and this law depends mostly on two parameters, the median diameter and the dispersion factor, which will help to see how wide the distribution is. From this particle size, droplet size distribution, you can also compute other characteristics. The first one is called the Salter mean diameter, so which is the ratio of the integral of the particle, the droplet size to the power of 3 divided by the integral of all the droplet size to the power of 2. And this actually provides you with a droplet diameter which has the same total volume to surface area than the entire spray. Another interesting characteristic is the span, which is also related to the dispersion factor that we saw. So it's the ratio between the difference of the D90 diameter, so it means the diameter for which 90% of the droplets are smaller, minus D10, which is the diameter for which only 10% of the particles are smaller, and D50, which is the median. And if you also go to another type of dimensional analysis, you will see that the median diameter is related to the nozzle diameter, but also to the operating pressure. And this relation, we will see that it has a very strong effect on the mitigation. So I will come back to this number. So remember that the median diameter is proportional to the nozzle diameter and the operating pressure. So another characteristic that you can that it's interesting to know, especially if you inherit from a spray that you have no idea what kind of spray it is, or if you want to have a more precise quantification of the distribution of the water, is to know the mass flux distribution. And von Karman, we developed a technique which allows to measure this. And it consists, as you see, as a moving array of test tubes where that you will open and close for a certain time. When you open, the water from the spray will fill the tubes with a distribution that is proportional to the mass flux, if you record the time it takes to fill these tubes. And you can travel this system along the whole spray to build the map of the mass flux distribution. You can see an example here for the full cone and for a flat spray. And now I can see, I'll show you like a live demo of this system, and you see that as you go closer to the screen, you see all the distribution. This was for a full cone. So one last important characteristic about a spray that will have a very huge importance for the mitigation is that the spray will entrain gas. So if you see here a simple experiment that was done with the water spray, and they were injecting a color gas, that's what you see, these four kind of jets. So that was just a color gas, and you see that they are clearly, this gas is entrained by the water spray. And there is a correlation developed by McCain, which is linking the volume flux of gas that is entrained by the spray over the liquid flow rate. And this ratio in the correlation is related to what we can call the spray factor, which is linked to the flow number. If you remember, it was the spray mass flow divided by the square root of the operating pressure, the square root of the liquid density, and the square of the nozzle, the square of this distance, which is the width of the spray, and it means that you will have a different entrainment at different distance from the spray. This correlation doesn't work very well close to the ground, because there you will have the effect of the impact of the spray on the ground and recirculation. So you have to use this entrainment for distance not too close to the ground. So now that we have a better idea of what is a spray, let's go now through the water curtain, which is actually simply an array of sprays. So usually it's either only one series of spray in a line, but you can also have several series of spray. So the water curtain can be defined by the height, so at which you position the sprays. They can be positioned downward, as we see in this picture, or upward in this one. You can vary the spacing between each spray and the spacing between each line. The spacing is chosen such that you have an overlap to form a dense cloud of water. And an important quantity for the water curtain is the mass flow rate per unit length, which is the use the nozzle density, which is the number of nozzle per length of the water curtain, the flow number again, and the supply pressure. Different parts of the talk that I will go now through the mitigation and especially the examples that were developed with the use of the code CASIMIR. So it's a French acronym, as this code was developed by the Von Karman Institute, but is supported by Total, which is a French company, and ENGIE, which is an energy company as well, French. The acronym means that it's a code to simulate water curtain mitigations. And with this code, you can actually model three different scenarios. First, the accidental release of a toxic gas, and there you will own flammable gas, so you will use mostly the dilution. I will go more in details after. But you can also model the accidental release of soluble gases and using more of the absorption model. Finally, you can also model scenarios of fire, in case of fire. And there, actually, there are two different possibilities using horizontal protein or vertical. I will come back later. So let's start with the gas release. So you can see here a very simplified version of the scenario. So you have the release source that is over here. This release source will create a gas cloud, and you want to mitigate it. So you position a water curtain here. And this water curtain will have different effects. So it will dilute the cloud as you will entrain gas in the spray. It can also heat the gas, if it's cold gas that was released. If the gas is soluble, you can also absorb, the water curtain will also absorb the gas. Which means on the other side, you will have a diluted cloud with different properties than before. Let's have a look first at the force dilution. So to be able to develop the model, there were several PhD theses that went through and several different types of experiments. So the first one were field tests, so that you can see in this video. So they tested chlorine and CO2 release with a water curtain, as you can see here. So in this water curtain, they could vary the nozzle diameter, the number of nozzle, the supply pressure, and they could also vary the the release flow rate. And since they tested different days, the meteorological conditions were varied as well. The main parameter that was measured here, it was the concentration of the gas before and after. And for the chlorine, they used they were trapping the chlorine in a soda solution that was analyzed later. For the CO2, they used infrared probe. But since field test, it's very difficult to control the ambient conditions. In parallel, they also performed a test in a wind tunnel, which is the wind gallery available at the von Karman. So this wind tunnel has a 1 meter by 1 meter test section, as you can see here, and several meters long. And it consists, so the wind is generated by several pump ejectors, which means that you, it's an aspirating flow, which is good for gas dispersion because you will not recirculate the gas and you can filter it at the end of the test section. The test was scaled to 1/4. They were releasing different types of gas, SF6, CO2, but also liquid nitrogen to have the thermal effect. So I forgot to mention that all these gas are weakly soluble, which was in purpose to really try to model the dilution and not the absorption. And for the wind gallery, they used isokinetic sampling probes and hot wire to measure the concentrations. You can see some videos of the wind tunnel, so the cloud that is generated in the wind tunnel, and then once the spray is activated, you see that the cloud, you have a circulation here, and the cloud is diluted. And you see that it's very comparable to the field test video that you see above. In parallel to the experiments, there were also numerical simulations performed. So for the air, they used the RANS approach using a K epsilon turbulence model. And the droplets were simulated through Lagrangian tracking. So the spray was actually a set of trajectories that would fit the liquid flow rate and the droplet size distribution of the actual spray. And you can see examples of all these trajectories here. So in that case, downward and upward curtain were tested similarly to the wind gallery experiments. And you see that the flow is different depending on if you put a downward and upward curtain. You see that if the curtain is downward, you will have the recirculation upstream of the spray as the wind comes from the left. While if you go to the upward curtain, you will see that the recirculation zone is downstream of the spray. So all of these, the field test, the wind gallery results, and the numerical simulation help to develop a correlation that is able to predict the dilution efficiency. And the dilution efficiency, you see here, is related to the mass concentration of the pollutant if only free convection plays, which means without spray, versus the mass concentration of pollutant with the forced convection, so using the spray. And you can see that this dilution efficiency is related to a term that was called the momentum ratio, which relates the liquid mass flow rate, the velocity of the spray, the wind velocity, the water curtain height, and the gas density. So what is interesting about this momentum ratio, so you see also that all of the different results are converging into this correlation. And you see also that for momentum ratio values about 8, you reach a very high efficiency of dilution. And to reach this high value of momentum ratio, usually the wind speed shouldn't be too high, because you see that it's in this term. So the water curtain will be efficient with low wind speed, but also you need it usually works with higher curtain, and it's an optimum to find between the curtain height and the nozzle size. So now if we look at the typical scenario, which would be a chlorine release. So the chlorine here, we would see either a 1 or 2 meter high cloud with a 0.1 kilo per meter concentration. And we look at the effect of two types of nozzle, Protex 5 and Protex 10. So you can see a picture of this type of sprays. It's a full cone spray. The difference between Protex 5 and Protex 10 is the nozzle diameter. And as you remember, if we increase the nozzle diameter, we will increase the droplet size. And as an exercise, we will change the wind value from 1 to 15. So you see the result here, which is the dilution efficiency versus the wind speed. And you see that for the different types of spray used, but also for the two cloud heights, the result is the same. So we have first the plateau with an efficiency where the wind has no effect. And after a certain value, the wind will start to play a role and the efficiency will drop. So you see that the plateau is influenced by first the droplet size, because you see that for a smaller droplet size, you will have a higher efficiency. But at the same time, the efficiency will drop faster with lower wind speed. So, of course, as the droplets are smaller, there will be less robust to the wind. But on the other hand, if you take the Protex 10, as you see here. So the droplet size are bigger, which means that you have a lower efficiency because you will entrain more pollutants, but you will be more resistant to the wind. So it's a compromise to look when you design the water. And you also see that you have better efficiency if the cloud is at 1 meter versus two. For if you check the curtain was 3 meters. So the higher is the difference between the water curtain and the cloud height, the better is the efficiency. So now if we have a look at the other phenomenon, which is the physical chemical absorption, it can become important in the dilution, in the efficiency of the water curtain when you use high, when you want to mitigate high solubility gas like HF or ammonia. For low solubility gas like methane or chlorine, as we saw before, it will have not so much impact. For this kind of absorption, the model that was developed here is neglecting the wind effect. So for the model to be representative, the best is to position the water curtain as close as possible to the release point. And you can see two different designs, either a downward curtain in different levels or an upward curtain that is positioned on the ground. So the modeling that was used for the absorption is based on film theory, and the idea is that the flux density of pollutant that will be absorbed in the droplet for the gas size is related to the difference of the partial pressure of the pollutant, which is supposed at far from the droplet not affected, and then the partial pressure of the pollutant close to the droplet. And use also the gas convective mass transfer coefficient. And this coefficient depends on the Sherwood number, which is a non-dimensional number that will see the importance of the convective versus diffusive mass transport, the diffusive coefficient here, the molar mass of the gas, the temperature of the gas, the universal gas constant, and the diameter of the droplet. So you see that that's why you have the I index. All of this model will change depending on the droplet size. So you will have mass flux per droplet size. On the liquid side, the model assumes that the pollutant is in a small film around the surface of the droplet, and that the pollutant will diffuse into the core of the droplet. And this concentration difference is related also to a liquid mass transfer coefficient. To calculate this, to be able to find the flow rate of pollutant that will be absorbed by the droplet, a very important quantity in the Henry constant that you see that comes in this equation. And this is a ratio between the concentration of the pollutant in a liquid over the pulpar pressure in a gas. And you can find this Henry constant in table. So that's something that that is known. And then once you are able to calculate the mass flux of pollutant absorbed, you can also look at the absorption efficiency by doing a ratio between the absorbed micro rate and entrained micro rate. So if we go back to our example of before, so it's similar nozzles that we've used. Here we will play also with the operating pressure, but this time we use ammonia or NH3 to have a gas that is more soluble, and we will see more the effect of this phenomenon. And the concentration is also higher, 0.3 kilopometers per liter. So if we look at the results, you see, as expected, that for the Protex 5, you have a lower droplet size than for Protex 10, because the Protex 10 had a higher nozzle diameter. You see also, if you remember, that the median droplet size was proportional to the nozzle diameter, but also to the operating pressure. You see that the higher the operating pressure is, the lower will be the droplet size. And this translates in an effect on the absorption efficiency, because you see that the efficiency will increase when the pressure increases. And you see that it's the same for both. But as this one had higher droplet from the beginning, the efficiency would be lower. So smaller droplets improve the absorption. So recommendation for this would be to use smaller droplets because as they have higher surface area to volume ratio for the same mass flow rate, they will promote the mass transfer between the gas and the water and then increase the absorption efficiency. The problem with smaller droplets, as we saw from the dilution example, is that they will be more sensitive to the mechanical action of the wind, and also they have less chance entrainment. So now we go to the last part of the talk, which is the thermal shielding. So as I mentioned before, we have, if we want to protect let's say here a reservoir from a fire or anything, you have two solutions, either a water curtain similar to what we saw before for the gas release, but you can also use a water curtain impacting the reservoir, and we will see the effect of the two. Similarly to what was done for the gas release, field tests, but also laboratory tests were performed. For the field test, it was mostly LNG fires, as you see here in this picture, but they also did gasoline fires. You can see here that for the LNG, there was the water curtain in two lines. And on the other side of the water curtain, radiometers were positioned to measure the radiation emitted by the fire. And you see an example of measurement here, where you have the curtain on and off, and you see that the heat flux received by the radiometer can be decreased by up to 70% when the water curtain is on. In parallel to this heat test, which are quite impressive, lab tests were performed. And there, instead of a fire, it was gas burner that were used. And they use up to 10 kilowatts. And they use an aluminum reflector to concentrate the heat generated by these gas burners to reach a heat flux of 11 kilowatt per meter square, and you see that this is a typical value that was measured for the real fire there. Again, the measurement was done with radiometers. So if you look at both the field test and the laboratory test, you see that the attenuation of the radiative heat is increasing if you increase the linear mass flow rate. So which also related, and you see in the field test that you also see that when the pressure increased, the thermal performance were better, which is related because when you increase the pressure, as you remember, we will have smaller droplets, which will increase the droplet concentration, increase the liquid surface of opposed to the radiation. So it's better to use high pressure with a moderate amount of nozzle in this case. We also see that the trend was similar between the field test and the laboratory test, which led to a modeling of this. And the modeling is based on what is called two flux model. So the assumption is that the spray is a semi-transparent medium, and they did very complicated calculations of the spectral mechanism using absorption, emission, and scattering, both in the vapor and the droplet phases. But at the end, if you do the integral of the attenuation over the whole spectrum, they found out that this total attenuation follows the Bayer-Lambert law and can be predicted using this K factor, which is nautical thickness, and it depends again on the linear mass flow rate, the density of the liquid, the velocity of the droplets, and the south terminal diameter. For the horizontal shielding, you have one more effect that takes place, is that the spray will impact on the surface and will generate a falling liquid film. And so to model this, you need to add another term with another optical thickness that can be modeled using an extinction coefficient alpha that was determined experimentally, but also the delta, which is the thickness of the falling liquid film. And you see that with this very simple model, they were able to reproduce the measurement data, except for this point at the top of the wall. And why? Because the model doesn't take into account the splashing of the spray. And as you have this splashing effect, you will actually have also a liquid film upward that was not modeled. So last scenario. So we want to protect a 20 meter high by 20 meter diameter tank that would be exposed to a very big thermal radiation of 60 kilowatts per meter squared. What should we choose? Should we choose the horizontal or vertical shielding? So if we use the vertical shielding, an optimum design show that you can reach an attenuation of 61%. But with only one single water curtain, they realized that you would not protect properly the extremities of the tank. So that's why three different rows of water curtain were used, which relate to, as I said, 61% attenuation, a total consumption of 204 kilo per second of water, but could sustain wind up to 4 meters per second. So now if we look at the same scenario, but using an horizontal, then as it's horizontal, a lot of more nozzles were needed. You see that you have almost 900 nozzles compared to 200. The same nozzles were used as comparison, but you see that in this case, the attenuation is very high, almost 100% in the bottom of the tank. But to reach this very high attenuation, you need a lot larger mass flow rate, which is 84% higher. Another concern when you use the horizontal shielding is you want to be sure that you have this liquid film, because that's what makes the improved attenuation, the fact that you have this liquid film on the surface. So there is also a thermal model that was implemented to calculate the liquid film temperature, and you see that in this case, it's 70 degrees, which is far from the boiling temperature, so you would avoid having part of the surface that are not exposed to the liquid film. So as conclusion, the water curtain can be very efficient to mitigate toxic gas release, but also to protect tanks, buildings, or personnel against fire. If you look at the toxic gas release, you have the absorption model that is not taking into account the wind. And the effect strongly is related to the type of gas, but also the droplet size. For the force dilution, it's very efficient at low and moderate wind speeds. And you need to, when you design such curtain, have a trade-off between the gas entrainment and the resistance to the wind. And another recommendation is to place the curtain close to the release while avoiding affecting the pollutant source. Finally, for the thermal shielding, when you use vertical curtain, it's better to use thick curtain with high pressure, as you want to have small droplets. For the impacting curtain, since the efficiency is mostly related to the falling liquid film, the droplet size doesn't matter so much. But the model that was developed doesn't include film evaporation, which might be a problematic if you see that the temperature of the water increases. So I put here also the some reference of the main PhD thesis that helped to develop the different models that are presented here. So thank you for listening, and don't hesitate if you have questions.
Thank you so much for very interesting presentation, very comprehensive as well. You managed to cover lots of topics in terms of the mitigation using water curtain, which is very interesting and very important also for the industry. And there's lots of physics in there. In the background, which is also very interesting. So now we have time for some questions. I know that I received some from the YouTube, but I'm wondering first on here on the Google Meet if anyone has any particular question that would like to ask to Dr. Delphin. Just remember to unmute your microphone if you want to drop the question. No questions? Okay, so while these people were thinking a little bit, I got some here from the YouTube. Okay, so the first question that we received from the YouTube, it's related to the large scale process errors in terms of the optimization. So the question goes like this: what would be the limitation, the optimization for large-scale plants once the droplets can collapse together? So I suppose that the asker is trying to understand if you have different droplets and if they get together and they change their size, what would be the effect? He is concerned whether the absorption would increase or decrease. And also, and guarantee the efficiency of the optimization system for large scales.
Okay, that's a very good question. I'm not sure about this because I actually don't know because I know that the model was developed for curtains, so I guess this is somehow taken into account in the model. But it's true that what I explained is really the basic of this, which is only on small droplets. So I don't know. I think I have to check.
Okay. Yeah.
So, but if this person, I don't know who it is interesting, you can send me his email or coordinates, and I can check and answer.
Okay, lovely. Yeah, we can
because this is a very detailed part of the model which I'm not aware.
Yeah.
Because I did not develop it, but I'm sure it was it's somewhere. So, I'll answer later.
Yeah. Well, there are couple of other questions here. So the second one is, did use of water coating in fire protection The curtain aims to decrease thermal radiation, or is it meant to extinguish the fire as well?
No, in this case, it's just protect. So you don't. The idea is to really do like a barrier. So you will put this curtain as a barrier. So it's not. And the model doesn't. Because I know that one idea to go more in to develop this model would be to actually try to use extinguishing device of the firefighters to see how this actually also is attenuates the radiation.
Yeah.
But for now, what was developed is really water bottles, so sprays.
Yeah.
Not the machine, the lensing system from the firefighter.
I see. There's one other question here is that have you ever considered or have you ever heard of any initiative that uses another fluid instead of water? In terms, it might well be that you have some specific risk where you don't want to use water, but you want to use something else, any other fluid. So
what I know is the opposite is true, because you see that the absorption model, you need soluble gas that it's solubility. You could also increase this effect if you want to put chemical reactant in the water. So this can, I know that they investigated that. But the model could be used with the other fluids. You just change the properties of the fluids. Of course, you need maybe to re-measure the spray characteristics because if the fluid is different, maybe you will have a different atomization and then you would have to adapt the properties. But so I mostly know water because also water curtain is supposed to be something cheap. So if you start to put more fancy products, then you kind of lose the point.
But
I think there's no real issue with that.
I have another question here from the YouTube. So let me see. In risk mitigation management, the activation of water curtains would be the first thing to be chosen when hazard releases occur. So that's a question. So essentially, if something goes wrong in terms of gas, I'm supposed that the one who's asking the question is mentioned like a gas release or a fire or something like that. So they are asking, is that the first thing that should be activated? In industry, it's used with or with a specific type of mitigation?
This, not really for industry, so I will be careful with what I answer. what I would more say the opposite, that it's one of the last barriers. Because the first thing you want to do is to stop the release. But if you cannot, or if the release has already released too much gas, then you can activate. But I know, for example, in France, they have to prove the efficiency of some last barriers to be sure that it will not propagate into housing or things like this. And water curtain is one of their measures.
Mm-hmm.
I would say not the first one.
Yeah. Well, you don't want it to come to the point where you have to release the water, isn't it? You want to make sure that everything is under control.
Exactly, because also it might damage equipment.
Maybe the next thing that comes once you release the water is just, come on, guys, run, move. You need to evacuate. But anyway, okay. I have myself one question, maybe one curiosity. When I was following your presentation in terms of the mitigation with ammonia and stuff like that, so we were presenting very interesting results about the size of the droplet and how that surface air would increase absorption and things like that. But one of the things that came to my mind is that we normally forget that ammonia, it's also flammable. So it means that it can burn. And then if you have very tiny particles or very tiny droplets on the other side of the spectrum, that will increase the turbulence. And then if you have an explosion, that's not a good thing to have, right? So I've seen some
studies. Okay, but the gas So it's the gas that will be diluted. So, but you're right, the droplets will have ammonia, but water cannot be flammable.
Well, that's true, but I've seen things where you have very fine droplets, so it generates some sort of a turbulent field. So then if by any chance ammonia or methane or something else start burning, and then when you hit that turbulent field, then you enhance the explosion. So I'm wondering if you guys have done some kind of investigation or conducted any particular experiment where you evaluate the size of the droplets with explosion.
No, because they mostly focus on the mitigation. They never try to ignite.
Yeah.
Because I know they did LNG, which can also ignite. No. But also the experiments that were based on this, mostly the gas were not flammable. Because it was safer. But later on, they extended toward the gas. But I don't know, the flammability was not taken into account. Yeah. But normally you dilute, so you decrease the concentration and you hope that you are not anymore in the flammability limit. But whether it is or not, this is a good exercise. I'm not sure they checked that. That's a good idea.
Okay. Another thing which is maybe it's a very appropriate time or it's a huge coincidence. At the moment, we received a demand in our laboratory, and if someone is interested in trying to use like a water mist or something like that in order to mitigate a cloud, but not a cloud which is a gas cloud, but it's made of powder, very fine particles of powder. So there's one particular factory that is releasing this powder, as I said, but it looks, I mean, I think it behaves as if you were gas, as if it was gas. And then they are using water curtain to try to dilute, if you wish, and to block the disperse of these fine particles. Have you had any experience with this kind of modeling or experiments before?
So for in the frame of the mitigation, no, they only use gas. But as you say, I think if you can prove somehow that the particles are small enough to follow the flow, then maybe the models could be used. But that's a good point. I don't know.
Yeah.
But what we did with powder is we had a PhD student that investigated the dispersion of clouds like this due to an explosion. So there she developed measurement techniques to be able to track this cloud, both in velocity and concentration. But I think you know her, right? It's Charlene, one of my students.
Oh, yeah, yeah. You know
I think she will present in October, she told me.
Sorry, I lost my connect. Now I'm back. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Charlene, she will, I think she's going to be the third on the list. She's going to deliver us a seminar as well. And I'm so happy that she accepted the invitation.
So she will explain more about this. So dispersion of cloud with solid particles.
Yeah, that would be great. Yeah. Well, my mobile went off here. I'm just trying to get it back so to check whether I have any more questions. But in the meantime, I'm wondering if someone here on this room, in the Google Meet, if you have, and if you want to address a question, let me see what I have here. The animations and the presentation show that toxic flammable clouds more dispersed after penetrate the water because of flammable gas. Okay, I'll try to.
It's the same question, no? That you said.
Is it? In the case of flammable gas, it could continue dispersing flammable image. Yeah. Mainly concentration.
But then you need to know how much how you disperse, whether the. But this you could do because you know the efficiency of the dilution, so you can, let's say, recalculate and see whether or not you're in the flammability limit.
Yeah.
So I think it's case by case, this But it's a good point. I'm not sure if we didn't think about looking at this. It's a nice idea.
Yeah, one of the things, since we were discussing here, I was trying to follow all those questions and thoughts. It's that when you have the droplet, you do have a balance in between the tension of the water itself, the surface tension, and the high hydrodynamic forces caused by the flow, by the air. So it's always a balance in between the two, which can be measured by the Weber number, and then you can decide whether that particular droplet is going to break or not. And then if you break, it might well be a good thing, because we end up with smaller droplets. So I suppose that in the case of absorption, that's a good thing. But definitely,
yeah, indeed, yes.
In explosion, you have to be careful with this. You may end up with huge turbulence. Well, let me see here. I don't know if Tasia just dropped a question here, which is pretty much the one that I did. So I think it has been addressed. I'm wondering if anyone else has any other question that would like to ask to Dr. Delphin. Okay, Tasia, is there any other question from the YouTube? I don't have access to the YouTube at the moment. Not really. Okay, so if there's no more question, what I want to say is, thank you so much, Delphine, for accepting the invitation, for sharing your expertise and your research with us. It was really a pleasure. And I hope that in the future, in the near future, you can come and visit us and maybe spend some time here as well. We can teach with us. There's a lot of programs that we can work on. Some clarification for the people. I met Dr. Delphine a few years ago in Texas, right after her period there. So we met at the Mary Kay Symposium. And at that point, Charlene, I think she was pursuing her.
It was just degree. Starting.
Yeah,
it was our first conference.
Yeah, and then we went up by the hall of the hotel, and then we were discussing some sort of collaborations and things we could do. And then last year, I met Charlene again, and then she mentioned to me, oh, I'm on the process of finish this up, and then hopefully in 1 month time she's going to deliver a talk.
Yeah, it's actually next week, end of next week she will be a doctor.
Well, that's fantastic.
Very proud. Yes. She's my first real student that I followed from beginning to the end, so yeah. I'm very proud of her.
Yeah, that's really nice, and she's a really nice lady as well. So, yeah, congratulations to the two of you. Last year, I watched her talk. I attended her talk on the Mary Kay, and it was very interesting, very, very interesting what she was doing.
If you're interested by that, she gave a lecture for the NASA about her thesis.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
Maybe I can give you the link, because you can see it on the NASA website.
Please do that. Yeah, that would be.
I will try to find this.
Yeah, and I think if Maria is listening to us, I think we are good with the streaming on the YouTube, so we can also forward to Dr. Delphine later on, isn't it, Maria? Can you hear me?
Oh yes, Professor. I will finish the streaming.
And then you can send the link to Dr. Delphine, and she can get hold of the presentation as well.
Yes, maybe today later or tomorrow morning.
Yeah, I will go Brazilian to sleep. Time. So take your time.
She's going to sleep now, so it has to be tomorrow.
It's fine. You take your time.
Okay.